بسم الله، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. أما بعد، dear brothers and sisters، حياكم الله to the translation of the khutbah of today which is titled by doubts about Salafiyya. I began the khutbah by praising Allah, the one who informed the Khalaf about his pleasure and their, if they follow their Salaf, it means that he, Allah Ta'ala, informed the people who come after the predecessors about his pleasure, about his pleasure with the pious predecessors. As Allah Ta'ala said, as in Surah At-Tawbah, as in Surah At-Tawbah, Ayah 100, He subhanahu wa ta'ala said, والسابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار والذين اتبعوهم بإحسان رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه. لهم وأعد لهم جنات تجري تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها أبدا ذلك الفوز العظيم. And the former to embrace Islam, and the former to embrace Islam, and the foremost to embrace Islam of the Muhajireen, those who migrated from Mecca to Medina during the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Ansar, the citizens of Medina who helped and supported and defended and gave aid to the Muhajireen, and also those who followed them exactly in faith. Allah is well pleased with them as they are well pleased with Him. He has prepared for them gardens under which rivers flow, which are in the paradise, to dwell therein forever. That is the supreme success. I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship but Allah without any partners. I bear witness that Muhammad is the slave and messenger of Allah who clarified to his ummah the characteristics of the pious predecessors of it when he said the best generation is the one I am in. And then the one after it, and the one after it, as Imran ibn Hussein, the narrator or the reporter of the hadith, the narrator of the hadith رضي الله تعالى عنه said, I don't remember if Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم counted after his generation two or three generations. And the hadith is agreed upon. Afterward, all believers, verily under the shade of every of every matter that the Ummah face, there will be some people who are from the shayateen of mankind, pushed by the shayateen of jinn to downgrade and belittle the religion of Allah. Each time with means that fits it. And this type of people, have already attacked Islam and the messenger of Islam and the famous scholars of Islam along the history of Islam. Here is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the most beloved, one before Allah Ta'ala. Iblis and his soldiers harmed him and accused him by many different means of accusations, up until they, these followers of the shaitan, who show that they are Muslims, they even spoke evil about his honor, which is the most pure and perfect honor ever known. And they also spoke about his most beloved wife after Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And here they also attack the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who are the best companions of any prophet ever known, But when they fail, to establish the fire of fitna against As-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, because Islam was very pure at that time and the hearts of the people of Islam were very sincere and very pure upon faith, they failed. But at the time of Umar al-Faruq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they planned and they put many plots up until they killed him in his mihrab, where he lived, in the mihrab of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to lead the jama'ah of prayer. They killed him by their dirty hands. May Allah Ta'ala curse them. And as a consequence of the try of killing the heroes of Islam, if I would call them, as this requires a sacrifice of their children, the children of the planners of killing, the pious ones, as what happened in the incident of killing Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when they have assigned one of their children, Abu Lu'lu' al-Majusi, may Allah's curse be upon him, who was killed, and they were so definite that any one of them will try this, even if he success, he will be killed. So since this was assured to them, they decided not to sacrifice any of their children anymore. But they started attracting with their wealth some of the children of Islam, of the Muslims, who have weakened their iman by chasing the dunya and turning away from the guidance of the Quran and the Sunnah, who were attracted by wealth one time and by positions of authority another time and by brainwash in the third time. Here now, their success. They succeeded. They succeeded in their plans to have implementers of their plans from amongst the children of Muslims who are pushed to that with doubts that they have scattered around them from the like the doubts that they raised up against Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the one who is called the Nurayn because he had two of the daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa as his wives one after another. When the first passed away, when Ruqayya passed away, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa offered him Umm Kulthum. And when Umm Kulthum passed away, Rasulullah had no one vacant, no one free. Here Rasulullah said, if I have a third girl who is not married, I would have made her to marry Uthman. But yet, they accused Uthman. Of what? They accused him that he only offered positions to his relatives. Exactly the same accusation that they raise today against the Muslim rulers. And is this a cause? Is this a valid reason to destroy the whole country? To cause all this killing? Is this a cause? Is this a reason? Only for wealth, for money and positions, we kill each other and tear our security fear, and the masajid get abandoned because nobody can reach them, and who reach them is scared that they might be demolished over his head. This is all because of this and these plans of the enemies of Islam. Here they have succeeded in militarizing one of the children of Islam, or one of their children who they brought from Yemen, who is from amongst the Yahud, Abdullah bin Saba. And they told him to show more humbleness, more worship, more fear of Allah only showing to the Muslims up until it was the chance for them when the Muslims turned away from their religion to know it, what it is. Like them today, Muslims today are the lesser people knowing, are the people who know less about their religion than anyone else, except for a few of them. But the majority of Muslims know nothing about their religion. And now the Yahud are very successful in turning them away and making them to do whatever they command them from, which is not from Islam. Exactly like what the Yahud done with the Christians, because the Christians are arrogant of their religion. And the Yahud brought many things into their religion, making them to be the lower in rank, although they are more than them in number. Christians are more than the Jews. But who's the leader? The Jews, not the Christians. And this is what exactly they want to do with the Muslims. And that's why they sacrificed with one of their children, Abdullah bin Sabah al-Yahudi, although they knew that he might be killed. Exactly like their cousins, the Majus. The Majus who raised today the flag of defending Islam and defending Ahlul Bayt, and they are liars. They are liars. They are cousins of the Yahud. I just come across some information, an article that analyzed the position of Ahlus Sunnah in Iran. There is no any single masjid for Ahlus Sunnah, although Ahlus Sunnah are over 30% of the population of Iran. There is no single masjid for Ahlus Sunnah. While the Yahud in Isfahan have their temples or whatsoever they call them, are supported by the Iranian government. They are cousins. These people have offered before the Yahud, have offered their son Abu Lu'lu al-Majusi to kill Umar ibn Khattab and when in Salatul Fajri in the mihrab. So they done that. And now they built the largest grave, as they call it, mazar. A grave which people visit falsely, deviantly. They visit to seek the blessings from this grave of the man who killed Umar ibn Khattab. And the liars, how they buried him there when he was killed in Medina. He was killed right in the Masjid al-Nabawi. He could not escape. But they praise him and they call him Baba Shuja'uddin. Baba means father of them. They raise him to level of father, and then they say Shuja'uddin. He is the most brave one of our religion, their religion. Why? Because he killed Umar ibn Khattab, who was the second man after Rasulullah sallam, who was the second man with Rasulullah sallam, who was the one who Rasulullah sallam married his daughter, who was the one who Rasulullah sallam said that the shaitan escaped from the way that Umar ends, although Umar doesn't see the shaitan, but because of the iman of Umar. Oh, the one who was with the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr and Uthman over Uhud, on Uhud, and Uhud shaked when Rasulullah ﷺ hit it by his foot and said, "Firm Uhud, stable Uhud, only above you a prophet, a Siddiq, and two martyrs. Umar and Uthman." And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Umar, as well as he said to Uthman, he said to Umar, Islam has a door, and this door is not going to be opened by the kuffar, it's going to be broken. The door is you, Umar. And he told Uthman, people will come accuse you for the position of Khilafah. He said to him, Allah dressed you a thawb, and people will come try to force you to remove it, to take it off. Don't take it off. Rasulullah told Uthman, don't take it off, don't take yourself off. Uthman asked Rasulullah, what does that mean? Or later on, it was interpreted for him that it is the Khilafah. Exactly like what happened. So, here we see them succeeding, unfortunately, by bringing one of the children who showed Islam up until it was the time when the Muslims did not notice what he is planning, although Umar realized. By the way, this guy Abu Lu'lu'a was a smith who used to make swords and knives, and one day Umar radiallahu anhu passed by him and he found him making a knife of two side blade. He asked him, a knife of two side blade, what is that? He said, I'm making it for a day. Immediately Umar looked to his companions and said, he is threatening me. And it was for Umar, and he poisoned it for a long time, exactly like those who killed Ali radiallahu anhu did. But this one was from Kuffar. He never was Muslim. He was in Medina because he was a slave of Al-Mughira bin Shu'bah. But those who killed, yani Uthman and Ali, were from amongst the Muslims. Subhanallah. See how things go. These people, the Yahud and the Rafida, deceived the Muslims, the real Muslims, and the Muslims seem to believe them until today. Muslims seem to believe them. And I don't know how they believe someone who accepts that his mother sleeps with someone and his wife sleeps with other one and his daughter sleeps with other one and his sister sleeps with other one and his aunt sleeps with other one under the name of Muta. And they say that this is the best worship. But yet the Muslims trust him, while these children of folks, Khanazir, they accused the mother of the believers, Aisha, that she committed zina, although Allah Ta'ala freed her from this accusation. But they do not consider what they do with their mothers and wives and etc. They don't consider it zina. But yet the Muslims believe them. Although they know that the Rafida and the Yahud, the most liar people ever know. Liars. So they believe them. Exactly like the Yahud believe a Samari. As well Allah Ta'ala said in Surah Taha, ayah 96, قَالَ بَصُرْتُ بِمَا لَمْ يَبْصُرُوا بِهِ فَقَبَضْتُ قَبْضَةً مِنْ أَثَرِ الرَّسُولِ فَنَبَذْتُهَا وَكَذَلِكَ سَوَّلَتْ لِنَفْسِهِ. He, the Samari, said, I saw that they saw not, I say, I saw what they saw not. So I took a handful of dust from the hoof print of the messenger, meaning Jibreel alayhi salam, and threw it into the fire in which were put the armaments of the Pharaoh people, or into the calf that they worship later on. Because when they passed by a town and they found that the people of that town worshiping the calf, they said to Musa, assign us a god like they have a god. Assign us a god like they have a god. Thus my inner self suggested to me. That's what he said. So I said, if a Samari misguided Bani Israel during the lifetime of their prophet Musa alayhi salam, who Allah spoke to him, Allah spoke to three prophets only. Adam alayhi salam when he was in the Jannah, Musa alayhi salam on the ear, on the land, and a tour area, and Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam even above the Jannah, even above the Jannah sallallahu alayhi wasalam. So Musa alayhi salam, the prophet, in his time, a Samari could have misled his people, the Bani Israel. You know why? It is because they are a good land for misguidance. They welcome it. They love misguidance. They don't like Allah. They don't love Allah. They don't respect Allah. They don't worship Allah. And that's why any call for misguidance, they just follow it. Exactly like these ones of today. The Majus, the Yahud of this Ummah, the Yahud of this Ummah. So, if there was only one Samari during the lifetime of Musa alayhi salam, the prophet, could mislead Bani Israel, what about it today when we are 1,400 years away from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we have amongst us 1,000 Samari and one Samari. And we have amongst us 1,000 Samari and one Samari. And these Samaris are not like that Samari. That Samari was upon his own religion cover. Everyone knows him. Everyone knows him. And that's why they said to Musa, they all said to Musa, assign us a god like they have a god. Our 1,000 Samari and one Samari of today, they are not showing us that they are Yahud, but they are wearing like us. They are wearing like our ulama. They are speaking on the same time of our ulama. They are deceiving us. They are deceiving us. So these Samaris of today, the one, as I call them, the 1,001 Samaris, there are more than that, but I'm just giving a number to show you that there are so many, so many today. And they know from Islam what the majority of Muslims do not know. And that's why they tell them Islam is like this, and they believe them. They believe them. They believe them. And I'm not talking about Muslims, common Muslims living at the edges of the Muslim countries. I'm talking about Muslims who are living at the depth of the Muslim world, even around the Kaaba in Mecca. There are yet some people giving their ears to these Samaris to whisper into them their dirt against Islam, making them understand that this is Islam, convincing them with it. So they, these Samaris, the 1001 Samaris of this time, they did the same as the first Samari. They took a handful of not the dust as that Samari did, but the dirt. The dirt, shirk, bid'ah, disobedience to Allah and His Quran, disobedience to the Sunnah of Rasulullah. When Allah called them to obey Allah and His Messenger and the rulers and the scholars, they refused it. So they encouraged the ignorance of this Ummah to turn the security of their lives to fear, to replace security of their land with fear, and tell everyone in their home, all home, they, these Muslim children, are the ones who are used by the either the pure kuffar or those who call themselves Muslims but they are not, and Allah knows best. They tell their fathers, their mothers, their sisters, their brothers, their children, by causing all these fitnas in the Muslim countries, so the father doesn't go to open his shop, because he knows very well that if he goes to his shop, one of those friends of his son will come and kill him, and maybe his son is with them at the same time. His mother will not be able to go to the hospital because she is scared that those whom her son encouraged and influenced is going to kill her in the way, or maybe in the hospital. His sister, his wife, his daughter, they scared that they might be raped on the way to school or to the market or to the hospital. So they remain home. Everybody, schools are abundant, mosques are abundant, shops are closed and abundant. All of that is why? It is because Yemenis in the capital of Yemen causing this terror. Egyptians in the capital of Egypt causing this terror. Tunisians in the capital of Tunisia causing this terror. Bahrainis are in the capital of Bahrain doing this terror, and so and so, and so on and so on. And yet we hear some people calling Saudis to do that and terror even the Hujjaj and Mu'tamirin, so no one will come, like the old days. I still remember when Mecca used to have only a little number of Hujjaj, because it was difficult for them to come. One reason was fear. But today, not only Hajj, not even Ramadan. Just 2 days ago I was in the Haram, in Mecca, in Masjid al-Haram. It was so packed, like if it is Hajj or Ramadan. Why? It is because the security that Allah blessed us with, they don't like it. They want to tell all Muslims all around the world, making them stop coming. No one will come. Even if someone is so interesting to come, his mother will stop him because she fears that he goes and never comes back. His wife will cry, holding his heel before he even step out of the door, because he's going to turn his children orphans, and so on. So these all are only caused by the influence that the kuffar and the supporters of the kuffar who hate the real Islam are doing. And they turn even the blessing and grace that Allah Ta'ala bestowed on their countries to hunger. Look at it in the capitals of these countries. When I was watching the news one day in the just last few days, I was shocked and I thought that I'm looking to the news of maybe somewhere in Africa where it is very dry, people carrying containers to have a drop of water. I said, Subhanallah, is this happening in these countries? It's impossible. Countries that a river crosses, running from the high mountains of Africa, they carry containers to find some water to drink. It is not possible. But it happened. It happened, Ikhwan, because terror. Because terror. Because of fear. And so, the honor that they had stands to be what? Stands to be what? Dishonor. Now, Muslims are lower. Muslims are lowers because they lost the honor that Islam provided them when they were upon the real Islam. When they were upon the real Islam, Allah Ta'ala blessed them with honor, as He blessed them with security, as He blessed them with province and grace and sustenance. And that's all after they absorbed the ideas of the kuffar. The ideas of the kuffar. Demonstration, innovation, shirk, whatsoever. So they destroyed the whole earth, beginning from the aqidah of the ummah, which they inherited from their pious predecessors, who brought it to us from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they now are raising, they are raising the flag, what I call the flag of mud. We are all from the same land, that's all. Forget about Christianity, forget about Islam, forget about Sunnah, forget about Shia, forget about Bid'ah. No matter what, you are upon of the creed. No matter who you worship, no matter who you curse, even if you insult Rasulullah, no matter. The important thing is you and I are from the same land. No, ya Ikhwan, that's wrong. That's wrong. We don't encourage the citizens to harm other citizens if they are upon different religions. It's up to them. We don't force nobody to come to our religion. We force nobody to come to our sunnah. But it does not necessarily mean that we unite upon the mud, upon land, but not upon religion. No. My love is only for my brother who's upon the same religion that I am upon. I'm not going to give my love, which is the most valuable thing that I own. I'm not going to give it to whomsoever who carries the same nationality if he doesn't respect my religion. If he's not upon my religion, if he's not upon the sunnah, I'm not going to respect him. I'm not going to respect him. I'm not going to give him my love. No way. My heart has no rule for anyone who's not from al-sunnah. Has no room for any one of them. They are already out of my heart. They never been in. They tried and tried. But my heart is so sealed against al-kufr and al-bidah. And that's why these people describe our pious brothers and sisters by very, very bad things. That not even Muslims, people of a sunnah, will not accept, but even the honorable even honorable kuffar, people who respect their war, people who respect themselves from even amongst the kuffar, they don't accept. No one accept. No one even from the kuffar accept to call Umar what the Shia calls him. No one accept, even from amongst the kuffar, to call the wife of Rasulullah the way that the Shia described her. No one accept to call Uthman like what even said Qutb called him. No one accept that, Ikhwan, no one. Even if that from the kuffar, because as Shaykh Islam Taymiyyah said, these people are even more misguided than the Yahud and Nasara, because the Yahud and Nasara respected and loved the companions of their prophets. But these people, most enemy ones to them are the companions of the prophets. They may ask Allah to be pleased with Abu Lahab, because he's uncle of Rasulullah. Although this uncle of Rasulullah disbelieved in him and he accused him, but he's why not? If they praise and love Abu Lu'lu al-Majusi who killed Umar and he is kafir, but at the same time they hate Abu Bakr, they hate Umar, they hate Aisha, they hate almost every one of the Sahaba except for handful only, as they say. So these people, as I said, it is all believers, it is not good for a believer who respects himself and respects his religion to go to follow the plot of the kuffar, the enemies of Islam, and I call them all kuffar. These enemies of Islam, of a sunnah, all kuffar. To go behind them, to follow them, and to take their plans of destroying Islam and you implement it yourself, this cannot happen from one who respects his religion. So this is what they have accused the Salafiyya with, which is very bad. They themselves deserve it more than anyone else on this land, more than anyone else. They deserve these descriptions, bad attributes, bad names. So yesterday, meaning in the past, at the time of Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad, Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, at these times, they accused these people, I named, and the others like of them, they accused them of what? They said, they are jamidun, they are solid mind, they don't think, they are stupid, that's the meaning of it. They are muqallidun, are only imitators. They are hashawiyya, meaning they just fill in their hearts with information that is not valuable. They fill in their books, like books of Bukhari and Muslim, with things which is not valuable. And they call them mujassima, because those ones deny that Allah is on his throne. He said there is nothing on the throne. And if you say Allah is on the throne, then you are describing Allah like a body, a visible body like yours. So they said Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they describe Allah like that. He is settled on his throne. They say, okay, as long as you Ahlus Sunnah say that, then you are mujassima, people who give a shape to Allah. Say no, this is all wrong. We don't give a shape to Allah, but we only admit what Allah Ta'ala informed us in the Quran, that he settled on his throne, as in Surah Taha. And they called him very bad names, like people of the yellow books. What's wrong with the yellow books? Bukhari, Muslim, because they, in the old days, they were yellow pages. Because they don't want yellow books. They don't want yellow books, which has which have ilm. They want newspapers only. They are ulama of newspapers. And in another time, they attacked the aqidah of Islam. And they called it in one time Wahhabiyya. So they turned people away from what is Wahhabiyya? What is Wahhabiyya? Wahhabiyya means you follow what Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab brought up. Okay, let's see, what did he bring up? We have his book, Kitab al-Tawheed. Nothing, it's not a compiled book. It is not a compiled book. It is a gathered book. It is a book that has only ayat from the Quran, a hadith from the Sunnah, that's it. Is this something wrong? Subhanallah. And your people who write many books from their own brains, no ayah, no hadith, that is something good? Subhanallah. So, and they, in these days, they call it, they give it some names, like Irhab. They say it is the Salafiyya Irhabiyya. Why Salafiyya? Which they surround it falsely and unjustly. They surround it with many different bad descriptions and attributes. Salafiyya is the only thing that fights against terrorism. Forget about what they were doing. They were not success. Till today, they cannot even secure their countries of their own terrorism, rather than it outsiders' terrorism. But Islam, which is Salafiyya, which is Islam that Rasulullah came with, this is the thing that can guarantee security and can fight against terrorism. This is the only anti-terrorism method. That is the only thing. Because in Quran, Allah Ta'ala warned us against terrorism. In the Sunnah, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam warned us against terrorism. Even with the kuffar. Yes, Allah Ta'ala said, وَأَعِدُّ لَهُمْ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَمِنْ رِبَاطِ الْخَيْلِ تُرْهِبُونَ بِهِ عَدُوَّ اللَّهِ وَعَدُوَّكُمْ. And prepare whatever you can of horses and weapons, so you tell the enemies of Allah and your enemies. Tell them how, so they don't come and attack you in your land. Yes, it is a right for all nations, every country. And no one can say this is wrong. No one. Every country has to build up their own defense, so no one come and accuse them. No one come and attack them. No one come and capture their land and colonize it. It does not, the ayah does not say go and tell the others and bomb in their land and kill their people. No, this is, the ayah does not say that. So, Salafiyya, as I said, and then I said, all people, all slaves of Allah, let us then know what is the reality of Salafiyya. When we just hear from the others, let us know what is Salafiyya and what are the doubts that they scatter around it. Salafiyya, our people, is the proper belief. Is this something bad to have a proper belief? Subhanallah. If I believe that no one has the right to be worshipped but Allah, is this something wrong? If I don't slaughter for other than Allah, is this something wrong? If I don't bow or prostrate for other than Allah, is this something wrong? If I don't call Allah names from my own self, but I only call him with names that he called himself with in Quran, or what has been authenticated in the Sunnah of Rasulullah, is this something wrong? Salafiyah is to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your worships. Is this something wrong to pray like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? When he said, pray like I pray, like you saw me pray. Is this something wrong that you perform Hajj the way he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did? When he said, لِتَأْخُذُوا عَنِّي مَلَاسِكَكُمْ, take your rituals of Hajj from me. Is this something wrong to fast like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Is this something wrong to have good, to have relations with everyone the way Rasulullah ﷺ had it? Is this something wrong? Didn't Allah Ta'ala say, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنُهُ فَانْتَهُوا, and whatsoever the Prophet brought you, take, and whatever he warned against, so stay away from it. Salafiyah is to fulfill your oaths and obligations and promises. Is this something wrong? Subhanallah. Salafiyah is to be honest. Is this something wrong? Salafiyah is to be trustworthy. You don't deceive, you don't cheat. Is this something wrong? Salafiyah is to respect. Is to respect all the religions and rituals. By the meaning, what is the meaning of respect? By to fulfill and implement all the obligations between you and others. All the obligations you hold between you and others, you have to fulfill. They are Christians, they are Jews, that whatsoever, up to them. We have a covenant, we have to stick to it. We have to stick to it. Salafiyah, or slaves of Allah, is the only thing that can guarantee the better life on this land, on this planet. In peace, without any fear or terror. Salafiyah, or slaves of Allah, is the thing that forbids khuruj against the rulers, but to advise them secretly and hiddenly between you and them. In a platform of love, not hate. Because when you hate someone, your advice is not going to be proper. And with respect, as they are the rulers. Salafiyah, or slaves of Allah, does not call to drop down the rulers because they've been for a long time there. They've been 30 years, 32 years, 40 years, no. But Salafiyah is only to drop the ruler when they call to kufr. But as long as they don't call to kufr and they allow Islam to be practiced, then we do not have any right to fight against them. But look to what's happening today, all around the Muslim world. Salafiyah, or slaves of Allah, is established on knowledge precedes sayings and actions. Knowledge of Islam precedes of any saying that you seek reward of and action that you seek reward of. You must have the knowledge before, as Allah Ta'ala said to Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in ayah number 19, Surah Muhammad, فَأَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ, and know that there is no one worthy of worship but Allah, and then seek forgiveness for your sin. Salafiyah, or slaves of Allah, is a call that goes against the bid'ah, the innovations, the khurafa, the fabricated stories to tell people. The witchcrafting, magic, it is against the myths on land. Salafiyya or slaves of Allah is a call to return back to what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions were upon. That is Salafiyya, basically. When we say Salafiyya, we mean you need to be the way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was and his companions. Is this something wrong? You guys tell me. If there is something wrong, you just correct me. Say that it is wrong and tell me why. Is it because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was wrong? Then who can be right? If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was wrong, then who can be right? Who could be right? A Salafi, the person who is Salafi, the true Salafi, is the Muslim who establishes Aqeedah upon singling out Allah and Lordship and Godhood and in his names and attributes. He establishes worship based upon sincerity to Allah and following Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he establishes relations with others based on what is in the Quran and the Sunnah as the understanding of the pious predecessors like the companions. How did they deal? The companions had relatives who were kuffar. How did they deal with them? The companions had some of their relatives who were munafiqeen. How did they deal with them? Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, the head of the munafiqeen, his son Abdullah, also called Abdullah, was a believer. How did he deal with them? So we deal. How Rasulullah dealt with the Yahud in Medina, with the Christians in Najran, with the atheists in Mecca? How did he do? That's the way we need to go on. And that's how we establish our relations with others. The student of ilm or Salafi is not the one who raised big books. It's not the one who raised big books, no. It is the one who seek knowledge sincere before Allah and to remove the ignorance from himself, out of himself, and then out of the others. And on that he go gradually. He does not jump like many today in the East here as well as in the West. People just jump upon big books. Who did you study with? He might give you some names. When? Where? What did you study? Can we examine you? Can we ask you? He can't even answer any question. But he just come to teach and he tour around the world and he comes on TV channels and internet websites and he speaks. Subhanallah. Aren't we in the time which Rasulullah warned us against? We are wallahi in that time which Rasulullah warned us against, where he said that وَيْلٌ لِلْعَرَبِ مِنْ شَرٍ قَدْ اقْتَرَبْ لَا يَذَرُ بَيْتَ مَدَرٍ وَلَا حَجَرٍ إِلَّا دَخَلَهُ. Woe to the Arabs from an evil which is close to them now, which leaves no house built of mud or built of bricks except that it enters it, or tents except that it enters it. And we are in it today. This is the internet and TV channels. It's already entered. And you open the internet, you open the TV channels, you put it on, you see many different things. People speaking in the name of Sunnah, in the name of Islam, while they, when the ulama hears them, they say, who's the, who are these? What are they saying? Which language they are using? It's not the language of the ulama. It's not the language of the ulama. Now, whether they are speaking in Arabic or in English or in Spanish or in Urdu or whatsoever, the ulama still cannot recognize them. But they say, oh, we studied under so and so. Subhanallah. Okay, so and so is alive. Where did you study with him? We never saw you coming here. You never lived in that land. Oh, I studied over the internet. I listened to his tapes. MashaAllah, who told you that this is the way of study? Sheikh Albani rahimahullah was asked by one of very intelligent students of knowledge. Very intelligent students of knowledge who Sheikh Albani respect. And he was asked, Sheikh, I listen to your tapes very concentratedly. Can I say that I'm your student? He said, no. No, you can't. Simply because studying is the way Jibreel taught us in the hadith of Umar when he came in the form of man. And he sat next to Rasulullah ﷺ, knees to knees, and asked him. That is the way of studying. It's not just going, coming. On studying, you have to begin with the what we call the ulum al-ala. It's not correct that you are a student of knowledge when you don't even know what is the Arab in Arabic language. It's not correct, even if you are Arabs. It's not correct when you don't know usul al-fiqh, when you don't know mustalah, when you know nothing of these, just because you listen to some translations or some lectures in Arabic, and you thought that you are, mashallah, now. Or maybe you came to a Muslim land and you stayed by a scholar for a month or two or a year or two, and then you went back to say that I'm a student of knowledge. Subhanallah, how come? How come? Talib al-ilm, ya ikhwan, is the one who doesn't get involved in the major issues, but he go gradually. Alim, al-alim al-salafi, the alim who is salafi, is the one who calls to Allah abun basira, as Allah said in Surah Yusuf. أدعو إلى الله على بصيرة. أبون بصيرة meaning knowledge and hikmah, wisdom. And at the same time, as what Allah Ta'ala said, كونوا ربانيين بما كنتم تعلمون الكتاب وبما كنتم تدرسون. And be ربانيين meaning be of those who fear Allah, of the, fear the Lord, by what you teach from the book and by what you study. Ibn Abbas interpreted this ayah saying, Rabbaniyin are those scholars who teach the people from the low level gradually to the high level. They elevate them gradually. They don't jump them up. And I'm wondering, subhanAllah, in any field of science, they don't accept you jump from bottom to top. You have to go gradually. You have to go gradually. You cannot go from high school to do masters in medicine science. Even if you were the first one, the highest grade, and you're number one in the whole country, they still don't accept that because you're going to damage this science. You're going to destroy it. Because you don't have the tools. You don't have the tools. So you have to go gradually. And that's what the alim do. And this alim, the Salafi alim, is not someone who just waits for the praise of people. If you praise me, if these people of this era praise me, I go to them. If they don't praise me, but they don't have enmity with me, but they don't praise me, they don't put my name on top, then they are not good. I don't go to them. No, akhi. That is not the correct way. This is not the alim. You want to figure out the alim, this is not the alim. This is not the alim. This is someone who seeks only dunya affairs. Only dunya affairs. The jama'ah, which is the jama'ah salafiyya, is the jama'ah who all cooperate with each other to present Islam and implement Islam and fulfill Islam the way it was during the time of the Sahaba. and they do not have bay'ah, covenant with someone, oh, he's our leader. Who is not the ruler. Oh, he is a leader. He's a leader of our community. Let's put hand in his hand and say, we swear that we don't disobey you. This is wrong. This is wrong. This is only to Rasulullah in his time and to the rulers after his time. The Masjid al-Salafi is the one which is free of the views of shirk and views of bid'ah and the sayings and the actions which is established upon taqwa, fear of Allah. A masjid which the founder of it and the people who are using it are not ones who compete with others with, on which masjid is more beautiful than the other. Who has a more beautiful voice imam? But the masjid which is established upon knowledge of Tawheed and Sunnah and calls to this, because this is the thing that remains. Jam'iyya or organization which is Salafiyya, yes, there could be Jam'iyya in Islam. It's not correct to say, no Jam'iyya, we'll be in a mess. No, it is allowed, but there are principles and conditions for it. First of all, it must be established upon helping each other on the good. تَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. But not cooperating on the evil, because Allah warned us against that. From the evil is, oh, who's with us is with us, we love him. If he's from the other jam'iyya, from the other organization, we don't love him. Nah, then this is not a jam'iyya by the meaning organization to serve Islam. It is now an organization to destroy Islam, because we are splitting it. This jam'iyya followers or workers or cooperators, they do not like the ones of the other jam'iyya. That is not correct. We have to stop here. This is from shaitan. So we have to understand that. And we don't give any bay'ah, any covenant to the head of it. Oh, we promise you we don't work with the other jam'iyya. No, we cooperate with anyone who wills to do good. Who wills to do good. But if he wants to do bad, no. We don't cooperate with them. And if they have like this covenant, no, we don't cooperate with them. We don't help them in remaining on service of land if they don't want to be on Sunnah. And the Ummah, which is Salafiyya, is the Muslim Ummah, by the real meaning of Muslim Ummah, by truth, who established their religion upon what Rasulullah was on and the Sahaba, and their loyalty is to all the members of the Ummah, not on the color, not on the tongue, not on the tribe, not on the land. No, I'm a Saudi Sunni. I love every Sunni in the world. I love every Sunni who is upon the Sunnah in reality, whether he's Indian, African, Asian, European, American, American instead. Whatsoever, we love them. As Imam Ahmed said to one of his visitors, he said, when you see anybody on Sunnah, convey my salam to him and inform him that I love him for the sake of Allah. That is the proper position of the Muslim Ummah. We do not set enmity between each other because of the color or the tongue or the country or the passport or the flag or the land or the borders or the boundaries, but because of what is in the heart and what is being practiced and used of the religion. As Rasulullah ﷺ did not call some of his relatives brothers, but he called Bilal, who was black Abyssinian, brother. He did not call any of his relatives or the Arabs brothers, because they are of a different religion. But he called Salman al-Farsi, was Farsian, brother, because of his religion. That is the way we be with each other, and our loyalty, our love and enmity and hatred is based on that. Who is with us upon this, we love him, we are loyal to him, we help him. Who is not, we don't love him, period. We don't love him. As what Umar radiallahu anhu did with one of his relatives in Badr, when his relative was arrested kafir, and Umar passed by him, and one of the Muslims was holding him. He said, "Oh Umar, help me, I'm your relative, I'm your brother." He said, "No, he is my brother, not you. He is my brother, not you." Because he's Muslim, although he's not from even from the same family. But because he's Muslim, he's my brother. He's my brother, to whom my love is. Brothers and sisters, there is no any successful da'wah, except that there are hands which are covered with dirt, try to destroy it, to dirty it and destroy it, and that by spilling their blood or accusing their honors by one of two means. And that's what the Rafida, may Allah's curse be upon them until the day of resurrection, they are the enemies of Ahlul Bayt. They are the enemies of the companions of Rasulullah ﷺ. They say that the Salafis are the ones who call for the destruction and mess in the whole world, which is, and in their lives especially, which is completely wrong and false and fabricated by them. And in these lands there were some circumstances that allowed people who have weak iman, weak belief, who are only sick of position, they love position and they love fame. These circumstances made them to go and find a land to cause the fitna for them in their own land, without even looking to what come later on as a consequence of this. And they call the common people who have no much knowledge about the Sharia, they call them to come and stop and destroy the proper call of Islam, which calls to the Quran and Sunnah. That is the proper call. If you hear somebody saying to you, come to the Quran and Sunnah, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with that? And Allah Ta'ala said, as in Surah An-Nisa, ayah 65, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُ فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. But know by your Lord, they can have no faith until they make you, O Muhammad, peace be upon him, judge in all disputes between them, and find in themselves no resistance against your decision, and accept them with full submission. And here Allah Ta'ala said in the same surah, ayah 59, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم فإن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول إن كنتم تؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر ذلك خير ذلك خير وأحسن تأويلا. Are you who believe, obey Allah and obey the messenger meaning Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, and those of you Muslims who are in authority, and if you differ in anything amongst yourselves, refer it to Allah, meaning refer it to the Quran, meaning refer it to the Quran, see what the Quran says about it, refer it to Allah and His Messenger, meaning refer it to the Sunnah, Hadith of Rasulullah Sallam. If you believe in Allah and in the last day, that is better and more suitable for final determination. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith which is reported by Ibn Majah and authenticated by Albani, he said the Yahud, the Ummah, the nation of Yahud split it into 71 groups, one in the Jannah and 70 in the fire, and the Christians split it into 72 groups, one in the Jannah and 71 in the fire. And then he said, and by the one whom my soul is in his hand, my Ummah will split. My Ummah will split. His words and informs. So this is definite. Will split into 73 groups, one in the Jannah and 72 in the fire. Then the companion said, Ya Rasulullah, who they are? He said, Al-Jama'ah. Al-Jama'ah, the Jama'ah. The community, who is the Jama'ah? We need to know what is the Jama'ah. Is the Jama'ah now in number? Is it the largest number? What it is? It is the Jama'ah of Arabs? Is it the Jama'ah of Indians? What is the Jama'ah? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described this when the Sahaba asked him. In the hadith, in the other hadith, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, my Ummah shall be split into 73 groups, 72 in the fire and one in the Jannah, and it is those who are up on what I am up on today and my companions. That is the Jama'ah. It's not by the number. It might be you alone. If you are up on what Rasulullah up on was up on and the Sahaba, then you are the Jama'ah. As Ibn Mas'ud said, the Jama'ah which adheres the Haqq even if you are alone. Even if you are alone. If you are up on the Haqq, up on the truth, you are the Jama'ah. Not the Jama'ah, the number. No, it's not the number. So this is the way of the success of this Ummah and the protection from falling into the depth of destruction which the enemies of today, as the enemies of every day of this Ummah, try to build up barriers between the Ummah and this way, the way of success. And they describe it and its scholars and its people by very bad attributes and names to turn people away from it. And they stick to them bad and false accusations because they want the nations around the world to come all together against this Ummah. One time they say terrorism. One time they say this Wahhabism, one time say Albanism, one time say Bazism, Autonomism, Wattism, many isms. Many isms that they fabricate only to destroy the Ummah. Only to destroy the Ummah. Naam? And unfortunately, most of it today is blown by the home of Muslims. Of people who are born to Muslim parents, wear Muslim clothes, have Muslim skin, speak in Muslim tongue, unfortunately, as what Rasulullah said in Sahih al-Bukhari, and he called them, they call themselves dua who guide people. But Rasulullah said that they are dua who call people to Jahannam. And when you see, you don't see that they are calling to Jahannam. They don't call you to disbelieve in Allah. They don't call you to do zina or, but they call you to be good. But when you check, when you look, you find them not upon what Rasulullah was upon and the companions. He said, whoever responds to them, they just throw him in the fire. Hudhayfa, the companion of Rasulullah, when he wrote this hadith, he said, he asked Rasulullah, he said, describe them to us, describe them. How come we know them? He said, they are from our skin. Not necessarily mean the color, but Muslims. They're Muslims, right? And they speak in our tongue, not necessarily Arabic, but it means they speak in the tongue of Muslims. قال الله قال الرسول. But they are like